One quick announcement. While we are in Friendship Hall, we will remain seated throughout the entire service, no matter what the bulletin says. The only announcement that I know of is the breakfast on Thursday morning from 8 o'clock until 11, the annual 4th of July breakfast that's free for our community. I think they would still like some volunteers for help, so see Oscar. Let's do the call to worship now.
No, we'll do the prelude.
Oh, the prelude now.
We're going to do the prelude. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I'm not the praise band today. I'm Ed. Huh? Thank goodness. Yeah, okay. They're going to do a song that I wrote. I was doing my Bible study one morning, and the passage I read was about rescue. And these words came to my mind almost immediately. Rescue me, lead me to surrender. And I can't remember the exact biblical passage, but I found three passages that I'd like to read to you, if that's okay. This is from 2 Timothy 4:18. The Lord will rescue me from every evil attack and will bring me safely to his heavenly kingdom. To him be glory forever and ever. Amen. Psalm 34:22. The Lord will rescue his servants. No one who takes refuge in him will be condemned. Amen to that. And Colossians 1. Did I say that right? Colossians? Is that correct? 1:13 and 14. For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. Amen. So this song is called Rescue Me. Rescue me, lead me to surrender, follow me. I may go, show me to my destination, tell me everything I need to know. Rescue me, lead me to surrender, cover me with your perfect love. Hold me in your heart forever. Prepare for me a home with you above. You are the King. Your throne is our refuge. Who was, who is, who always will be. You are the Lord, the earth is your kingdom, heaven's just a heartbeat away. Rescue me, speak your words of wisdom, teach me how to walk in your way. Hold me in your arms forever. Protect me while I wait for judgment day. You are the King. Your throne is our refuge. Who was, who is, who always. Heaven's just a heartbeat away. You are the King. Your throne is our refuge. Who was, who is, who always will be. You are the Lord. The earth is your kingdom. Heaven's
precious heart beat away. Rescue me.
Beloved, when hope is high, abundance surrounds us, and we bask in the goodness of God's provision. God calls us to. When disaster strikes and need overwhelms the senses, and we carry the weight and worry of a perilous present and an unknown future, God calls to us. When we are moved with compassion, our hearts urging us to reach out to support our siblings in Christ, God calls to us. We easily give thanks for the good things in life, turning away from those which lead us to deeper community or second-guessing blessings as too good to be true. Let us pray. Living and faithful Spirit, the God in whom we live and move and have our being, the God who is made known in Christ Jesus, bless us one and all as we wait on you this day. Please remove from our minds and our hearts whatever impediments hinder worship or dampen our joy. Increase within us that holy longing for closeness which can open our lives to fuller delight and to a deeper commitment. May our hymns and prayers, our searching thoughts, and our hearing of the scriptures be an exercise in the holiest love. By you, with you, and for you, may our lives publish your praise in the name of Christ Jesus. Amen. Our hymn is He Touched Me, and remain seated.
Thank you.
this is not on the paper, but that just reminded me of years ago when Edna O'Dell would sing that for us as a solo. I hadn't thought about that in years, but yeah. We'll now have our tithes and offerings. Let us pray. Generous God, we offer our gifts with open hearts, recognizing that our generosity reflects our faith in you and your actions in the world. Just as the Corinthian church desired to give, may our giving be a reflection of the gospel in which we believe. Help us to share according to what we have, knowing that in the body of Christ, we are bound together in a relationship, offering help and hope to one another. Amen.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
I got here just on time. So when you see my wife, you can tell her that I can be prompt. Let me get all my paperwork down here and okay. Join me. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Join with me in our scripture for this morning. It comes out of the book of Mark, the 5th chapter, verses 21 through 43. It may take us the whole sermon. Verse 21 reads, when Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered round him, and he was by the lake. Then one of the leaders of the synagogue named Jairus came, and when he saw him, fell at his feet. And he begged him repeatedly, my little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live. So he went with him, and a large crowd followed and pressed on. Now there was a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years. She had endured much under many physicians and had spent all that she had, and she was no better, but rather grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak. For she said, "If I but touch his clothes, I will be made well." Immediately her hemorrhage stopped, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Immediately aware that the power had gone forth from him, Jesus turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing on you? How can you say, 'Who touched me?'" He looked all around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling and fell down before him and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, some people came from the leader's house to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." He allowed no one to follow him in except Peter, James, and John, and the brother of James. And when they came to the house of the leader of the synagogue, he saw a commotion and people were weeping and wailing loudly. When he had entered, he said to them, "Why do you make a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. Then he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha kumi," which means, "Little girl, get up." And immediately the little girl got up and immediately the girl got up and began to walk about. She was 12 years old. At this, they were overcome with amazement. He strictly ordered them that no one should know this and told them to give her something to eat. The word of God for the children of God. Heavenly gracious Father, we thank you for this place. We thank you for all of us that have joined together. Father, we pray that during this sermon, the Lord, that you will be lifted up and glorified. Father, I ask once again that you put me to the side and bring the cross to the forefront. It is through Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen. What a difficult life this poor woman has had. A woman with unstoppable flow of blood would be a tremendous burden on her family. And for 12 years, that's been her life. All clothes, all linens, all utensils and furniture she touched, sat on, or used had to be washed according to Levitical law. Likewise, people who touched her were considered unclean as well. Eventually, her ongoing condition seems to have led to her exclusion from her family. For we are told that she spent all of her money on worthless remedies of healing from doctors, and then things got worse after that. She lived her life without hugs from friends, without hugs from grandkids, and maybe not even hugs from her own kids. She had no rights. She probably had no income because she was simply unemployable. In a culture dominated by shame and honor, she experienced consistent and continuous embarrassment and exclusion. She was lonely. She was isolated. She was poor. After 12 years, her condition appears hopeless, and this lady is desperate. Most people might think that she would be better off dead. I always had the vision of this woman kicking and throwing elbows coming up through the crowd to get to Jesus. She couldn't get to Jesus, so she dives. As she is falling to the ground, her fingertips touch the edge of his cloak at the fringe of the garment, because this is a reference to the garment that Jesus is wearing. Today, we may call it a prayer shawl. The word for it in Hebrew is talit, and it's the garment that the Jews wore on the outside and is based in the book of Numbers in chapter 15. And it reads, "The Lord said to Moses, speak to the Israelites and say to them, throughout your generations to come, you are to make tassels at the corners of your garments. And you will have these tassels to look at, and so you will remember all the commands of the Lord." So is God giving his people a physical reminder of their identity or of who they are? And Jesus' day, they were doing this, and it was more like a shawl. This woman is pushing through the crowd surrounding Jesus, and she has this issue of bleeding. This would have made her unclean. She couldn't be allowed to be in any assembly. She couldn't have gone to the temple and worshiped in their services. She couldn't have been in a synagogue to celebrate and hear the words of the Lord inside. She was an outcast. Maybe she sat outside the synagogue this day and listened through a window, or maybe tried to catch echoes that are coming down the hallway or something. She has been an outcast. She is an outsider because of her physical condition. And she comes pushing through this crowd and brings up a couple things. She really has some guts, because she probably shouldn't be there, and she shouldn't be touching the garment, the hem of a rabbi. But she comes pushing, though. Pushing through the crowd, and she gets up there and she grabs the edge of his cloak, which has these tassels. Why doesn't she just grab the rabbi and ask him to heal her? Why does it say she grabbed his tassels? Well, there's a lot of Jews. There were a lot of Jews who were looking for the Messiah. And they looked to Malachi chapter 4, where it says that one of the ways that they will know when the Messiah comes is that there will be healing in his tassels, in his prayer shawl, and in his tassels again. So she grabs the tassels, and all of a sudden Jesus said, "I felt the power go out of me." Jesus felt this healing take place. And he immediately knows someone knows their scriptures. And I think this is what got Jesus' attention. It's like he says, somebody knows their Bible, and that somebody knows who I am. And he looks around and says, who is it? Who touched my tassels? Who touched me? And it's because she knows her Bible. She knows her Bible. And think about how hard this woman had to work to know what it says in Malachi. That she knows the scripture she's clinging to, and she's put all of her hope into this one piece of scripture. Because she can't go to the synagogue, she can't go to the temple, she has to be unbelievably committed. And I wouldn't be surprised if no one went out of their way to help this woman. She's a woman in a day when women were barely considered to be more than property. And on top of that, She's a woman who was unfit for assembly, and yet she knows her Bible, and Jesus says, "Who is this that touched me?" And so we are told that Jesus kept looking around to see who touched him. Then the woman knowing that she had been healed, came and fell at the feet of Jesus. And trembling with fear, she told him the whole truth. Can you imagine how this woman was feeling at this moment? She's being sought out by Jesus. She's being sought out by the Messiah. What would he do? Would he take the healing away? What kind of trouble can she be in now? It took an incredible amount of courage and faith for her to come forward and admit what she had done. It took extraordinary bravery to tell her story, to declare in front of everyone that was listening there. But Jesus knew what he was doing. If she had just crept away, would anyone have believed her? If she said that she was well now? After 12 years, would she have been accepted back into the family? Or back into society? By calling her out and making her publicity, tell her the story, Jesus just didn't feel her physically. He restored her in every part of her life. He gave her all the time in the world to tell her story. And she had his full attention. And Jesus looked at her and called her daughter. Not only was she publicly declared to be ritually clean again, but accepted fully back into the community. She was called daughter. She was called daughter by God's Son. Can you hear Jesus speaking that to you? Calling you son? Calling you daughter? Not only was she publicly declared to be ritually clean, but accepted fully back into the community. She got her life back. Do you know that? She was called daughter by God's Son. And instead of Jesus telling her not to tell anybody what is done, he was declaring it to the world so that everyone knew that she was restored in body, in mind, and in soul. So what does this amazing story say to each one of us this morning? How does this woman's story have a connection to our lives? What does it tell us about how Jesus connects with us? For one thing, we see, as we do in so many stories of the Bible, that even if no one else is interested in us, even if we are feeling isolated and all alone, no matter how the rest of the world treats us, Jesus has incredible interest in every one of us. In a world where it can seem like nobody knows our name, and nobody seems to want to know it, Jesus wants to know it. Jesus knows it, and Jesus wants to know all about us. Jesus wants us to know he cares. Jesus looks for us in the crowd. Jesus calls for us on a daily basis. Remember how Jesus compared the kingdom of God to a shepherd searching for lost sheep? What did the shepherd do? He left everything to go and to find the lost sheep. He searched high and low. He walked miles and miles and miles until finally he found it. Folks, we are lost in the crowd, and Jesus is searching for all of us. He's searching for us with his entire heart. And when he finds us, if we're willing to come to him and with him on the most amazing journey ever, there is a celebration in heaven that will change all of our lives. Folks, we are healed. We're healed. Being healed physically isn't promised. But what Jesus does is to bring the healing to our souls, our very being, restoring us to himself, calling us son and daughter, and calling us child. This life can be very difficult, can't it? It's very easy to feel forgotten, to feel misplaced, not wanted, or living out on the margins. I can't imagine how many of us feel this way. And Jesus is calling us. And he's searching for us in the crowd. We don't need to be afraid because Jesus loves us. Like the father in the parable of the prodigal son, he's waiting our return. He's waiting to welcome us back into the family. And when he sees us, he runs out to us, throws his arms around us, and invites us into his kingdom. And this just isn't an afterlife thing. It's a right now kind of thing in our world. Christ can be with us right now, right this minute, tomorrow, whatever time, Christ can be with us. We're never alone. There's things that maybe we forget who we belong to. And maybe we need to rejoice and be welcomed back into the fold. It's not our job to judge people, folks. None of us are perfect. I don't care what your mama said, none of us are perfect. None of us will be perfect in this life. It's our job to call people brother, sister, and friend. That's what God created. No matter what they look like, no matter how they smell, no matter who they are, what a relief that would be for them. And we are all called to do the same thing. And what we're all called to do is to love. And if we do that, God will do the rest. And the world will know that we are Christians if we love one another. I can't imagine how many people there are in this community who have been hurt by a church somewhere. I can't imagine how many has been shunned by a church. I wonder how many has been judged by the church. I hear the stories from people every now and then. The woman in her gospel lesson was on the outside and not allowed into God's assembly. She was on her own for 12 long years. Somehow she heard about Jesus. She heard about the healing that he was doing. And perhaps she had witnessed some, and her hopes in this story have become a reality for her. And you know what? On that day, she went for it. She went for it. And immediately her bleeding stopped and she felt in her body that she was freed from suffering. And you know what happened next? Jesus called out to her. Jesus didn't judge her. He called her. And she came to him and he said, "Daughter, your faith has healed you." Think about this. All you women, can you imagine that small, tender voice of Jesus calling you daughter? Guys, can you imagine that small, still voice of Jesus calling us son? Gives me goosebumps. This Jesus called her. He didn't judge her. And she came to Jesus, and he said, daughter, your faith has healed you. And then he says, go in peace and be freed from your suffering. And she became a daughter of the king. What kind of impact could we have in the community if we could be a place where people meet the real Jesus? How many lives would change if we could introduce them to the real Jesus? How many people would just be amazed at what God's allowing this church to do if we could just bring them to Jesus? It's to share the story in our own lives. We all have a story of Jesus. We all have that. We all have a testimony. Some of them may be long, some of them may be short. But I assure you, all of us here, all of us in this town, all of us in this state, all of us in this world, Jesus Christ knows our name. Not just ours, but everybody's. Can you imagine? And I've thought of this over the years so many times. Can you imagine hearing that small, still voice of God calling your name? Calling your name. Can you imagine him saying, well done, good and faithful servant? Can you imagine spending time with Jesus, just having a conversation, just like we do with our friends? What kind of things do you think you would ask Jesus? Because he's really personal. He knows everything about us, and he wants us to know him better. And what's the first thing that you think you would ask Jesus when you see him? After you got past the all and all the other stuff, what were some of the questions you could be with Jesus? Think about this week. Get a sheet of paper and write down some of those questions. One of mine's going to be, Jesus, why'd you make an aardvark? I don't even know what an aardvark is, but I know there's the name of an animal out there. What good is an aardvark? You know what else I would do? I'd be really thankful. I'd be really thankful with Jesus. And one of the things that I'm thankful for, and I'm probably going to get in trouble for this, I'm thankful for my wife. What a woman. She's got to be to love me. She's kind. She's sweet. And she's got a good left cross. What's the conversation you want with Jesus? Because we can have those conversations. It doesn't have to be a prayer that somebody else wrote. It is a conversation with Jesus of getting out of bed and say, Jesus, you got me again today. And Jesus will say, that's wonderful. Come, let's go do this today. Or you can get out of bed and say, Jesus, what's on the plans today? And it may not come immediately, but it comes out during the day. All of a sudden, you may run across somebody that needs something, or somebody that just needs a smile, or just someone that says that needs to hear, Jesus loves you. That may be the whole day. This woman in this story was cast aside because of her issue of blood. She couldn't stay in the same home with her own family. She had to be in a place by herself. For years, it was that way. And the other thing that would have been really embarrassing is if she was walking down the street or something and somebody was coming up to her, she had to scream out that she was having problems. She had to scream out what her problem was. I have the issue of blood, so people could get out of the way. But then Jesus comes along and shows her respect and love. Jesus comes along and gives her life back to her. That is the work of the church, is to meet people and give their lives back to them through Jesus Christ. Because that's the only way it's going to happen. So this lady knew her scripture. She knew she had to touch his tassels. She knew all these things. She was ready for Jesus. As we prepare to sing this last hymn, I want you to take a moment and think of somebody that may need to hear some good news that you know. Maybe you know somebody that just needs a smile. It may be in this service, it may be somewhere out there. Maybe you know somebody that needs a pick-me-up. Or maybe somebody just needs to hear from one of us that Jesus loves them. Because a lot of times in life we forget that. Even us who go to church. As they're playing something, if you would like prayer, I know this is a little different. If you would just raise your hand, I'll come to you. We can stand in the back or wherever you want to. But through Jesus Christ, we all go through stuff, and through Jesus Christ, there is a way out of our messes. So if you would, to please stand as we do something. Huh?
I'm not supposed to stay here.
Okay. Everybody sit down now. Too many rules and regulations in this church.